Hello again. Just before we get underway, a brief word of explanation is needed. This video was originally conceived and produced to be part of our recent Turbopump Part 2, which I hope you've seen. That video was getting too long, and it was thought better to release this as a separate video. So you'll hear a number of references like Part 1 of this video, or as seen in Part 1, and so on. And of course, I'm referring to Turbopump Part 1, which I also hope you've seen. Anyway, explanation over. I hope you enjoy the video. Now, in part one of this video, we went into, I think, considerable detail about the form and function of the V2's gas generation system. And in particular, we showed you quite a bit of information about the gas pot, where the hydrogen peroxide and the sodium permanganate combines to produce this chemically rendered steam by reducing the H2O2 and powering the turbine in the propellant pump system of the V2. What I want to do today is expose you a little bit more to a real gas pot rather than drawings and models and even very, very good 3D models that let me show you a lot of detail on the inside. I actually want to show you a real V2 gas pot. We'll explore the parts and functions of it in a bit more detail. But first, I'm going to show you a little bit of video about what we have to do to prepare an exhibit like this, bearing in mind when we get hold of something like this, it's often been in the ground for the best part of 80 years. Let's look at that now. This is how the steam generator pot arrived from central Germany. From the look of the rust, it might have been exposed to the elements for an extended period of its life. As far as the pot goes, it seems to be intact. And although I think it's a late war specimen, there's no sign of the thermal heat jacket around the pot, nor any sign that one was ever fitted. And it has this oddly neat hole that looks like it might have been struck by a pickaxe. The damage might have occurred in the explosion or impact that destroyed the missile it was attached to, but this looks more like low velocity post-mortem damage to me. It's got a few tufts of the fiberglass heat bandage that wraps the steam transport pipe still clinging on here. My plan is to prepare this as an Eagle Comics style cutaway, and I'm going to cut the pot open before I do anything else, in case the interior is rusted out and I have to rethink the whole idea. It's pretty good inside, and the detail I wanted to reveal is still intact. We can see the core tube and what I like to call the Helter Skelter, the two helicoiled flanges, or Wirbelblech swirl plates as the Germans called them. The funnel at the top has been damaged by whatever made that hole, but luckily, although it cut into the funnel, it doesn't seem to have damaged the all-important dual action valve, which looks surprisingly clean and shiny. Let me get some light in there. We can see the permanganate entry point at the back. We can see a hole in the bottom of the funnel. We'll come back to that in a bit. I've opened up the H2O2 feed pipe and we can see some nice shiny thing in there. And we like 80-year-old shiny things. A good contrast here between the extensive decay of the plain steel and the well-preserved stainless. Got all the bolts off and I'm just going to air chisel this off the top here. Neutralizing this ring of fasteners was easy enough. The studs all broke in a very consistent manner and with minimal effort when I put a spanner on the nuts. Nothing really holding this on now, just the studs have been twisted, so they're not parallel and centered in the holes anymore. You can see where the studs all broke within the thickness of the outlet flange. The connection between the flange and the pot was made gas tight with some kind of compound. It looks like the sort of stuff you might use assembling a car exhaust or muffler. I'm looking at a drawing here so that I can mark up the big locking nut on the top of the pot and avoid cutting into it too deeply. I don't want to go through a repetitive process of soaking the part in penetrating oil and then trying to undo the nut with a Stilson type adjustable wrench, as this risks doing too much damage to the soft metal. So I'm going to relieve the pressure on the threads caused by the rust by carefully splitting the nut with an air saw. You can see I've done an initial sandblasting treatment. I'll do more when I get the valve out. I need to saw down to my marks and then try splitting the nut. I think it's ready now. Okay. That's pretty good then.
Once the metal lets go, I can undo it with my fingers.
We have a lovely intact thread.
As you can see, I was able to cut into the ring without actually cutting through the threads. I could easily fill that saw cut in again if I needed to, but I'm happy with it as it is. The H2O2 funnel should just pop off the top here with a bit of prying.
And it's going to come straight out without a fight.
Again, some traces of a caulking compound visible here.
First daylight for the best part of 80 years. And we can see that the valve is just in absolutely excellent condition.
Sorry about the close-up of my sleeve here. I've got 8 minutes of this. What a wazzock. I was just too engrossed to think about the video. Anyway, long story short, as you'll see in a moment, the valve came out without violence. But I had to use a gas and air blower to heat up the steam pot first to break its hold on the valve. And here it is. Rust removed and painted, and the supporting metalwork straightened out. Let's just look at the outside of this first to make sure that we've recognised everything. These lugs are the method that the sodium permanganate tank is attached to the gas pot, or rather the gas pot is attached to the sodium permanganate tank. And you can see there's another one on the other side here. We've got another bracket on here for connecting this and stabilising the gas pot, but this rather fine little, rather delicate little bracket at the top here is for the sodium permanganate contact switch. And if we look on the body just here, we can see the main line that passes to the sodium permanganate tank sitting here. So sodium permanganate is pumped by air pressure into this point on the gas generator gas pot. And from this port here, where we've added a clean new nut to it, a flow pipe passes to the contact switch that's situated on here. And only when sodium permanganate arrives at this contact switch is the hydrogen peroxide permitted to pass into the gas generator. Basically, the catalyst, the sodium permanganate, has to be in the gas generator first. Now let's just turn it around so you can see in the inside compartment. I'm going to get that so it reflects a little bit of the light. I'm going to take the nut off the top here first. So the next thing in line here would be the combined 8-ton and 25-ton valve situated just above it about here. Remember, we looked at this in some detail in part one, so I'm not going to meditate on that too far. I really want to be showing you the gas pot rather than reaching back to things that we already covered in detail in part one. So let's just take the gigantic nut off the top here. Very special spanner used to seal this up. We can see this kind of castle-headed design. It really is a chunky piece of work. Let's just continue taking this apart. The funnel at the top here. This is manufactured out of one piece of steel. We can see the weld here where this top part was put on, but this part of the funnel is all one piece. And you can actually see that, I think, on the inside there, hopefully, that's just one piece of metal. The next thing we have on here is an aluminium washer. It's actually a very special washer designed to take a lot of force and to fill the gap. I'll just show you that as well in close up so that you can see it. This one's quite badly damaged because of all the violence that was done getting it apart, but you can see that in detail there. And finally, we have the valve. So this is the pressure constraint valve, and it's quite a another washer there underneath that sealing that up. So let's just put that down. Now this is pretty much the condition this was in when we opened it up. I've cleaned it up a bit, but it was nice and shiny like this. It really was like opening up a tomb, that gas pot, and finding this little treasure
on the inside. We can see that this is spring loaded. It's actually opening, and I can do that with the force of my hand. So that gives you an idea of what was going on with this valve. There's no actuation of it other than the pressure of the hydrogen peroxide that hits this from the storage tank. So the air passed to its storage tank, the elliptical storage tank, then drives the hydrogen peroxide through that funnel that we looked at earlier, down this pipeway into these apertures into here, and literally pushes that valve, that spring, out of the way and opens up that valve by its sheer pressure.
Importantly, the hydrogen peroxide pressure valve has two stages of operation. This is simple enough to understand, but the hardware needs some explaining, and I'm going to take it apart and show you its operation in detail in a moment. But I'll put it down for now and finish describing the steam pot.
Now, one of the first things that I want to show you is the rather surprising view down through the top. We can see this funnel here with a hole right at the center of it in the bottom that passes all the way through.
This pass-through hole might be a way of making sure non-destructive pressure was maintained in the pot if the bipropellant components had momentary variations in effectiveness due to temperature or changes in the concentration density. The truth is, I don't know exactly why they put this hole in the base of the funnel. What I do know is that the first designs for this type of thermal reactor pot didn't have this pass-through hole. The hole appeared sometime in 1943 and was presumably, like many other minor changes in this period, the result of their experience when the system was under intense ground and flight testing. And the most obvious thing the hole would achieve is to increase the flow of the exhaust gas and the propellants out of the pot. But another explanation might be that they wanted to heat up the core tube and prevent it having a cooling effect on the vigour of the chemical reaction. Either way, they were perhaps relieving one problem but creating another, less destructive problem elsewhere. A not uncommon scenario with the V2. This enigma of the hole is going to come up again later.
Let's just look at this Helter Skelter here. We can see there's been a lot of corrosion, but we've done what we can to minimize any rust with that. And you can see this helical pathway for much of the material that is erupting into here, into this space. There would really be a lot going on here with the sodium permanganate. This would be in a very aggressive combination of these two chemicals at the top here, with much of it shooting and spilling over the top of the hopper, landing and passing through these. I don't know whether you can see it. Let me just tilt that over again. You can see there are apertures here to allow the material to spill through into this helical skiway mounted around the central core, again allowing time to expose the hydrogen peroxide to the reducing effects of the sodium permanganate. So that's the best way of understanding this. It's about slowing down the product as it enters the gas pot and bringing them into proper contact and timed contact with one another to get a chance for the chemistry to really get going inside of the gas pot.
We get a better view of the Helter Skelter or swirl plates in this shot of the steam pot exhibit at the National Space Centre at Leicester in the UK. The pot has been cut open rather wider and cleaner than ours and at a different angle. And we can see the whole design in this drawing from 1942. The two plates were welded in place to form a helicoid around the core tube and form this turbulator system that increases turbulent flow and acts to mix the bipropellants in the pot. While we're looking at this internal drawing of the steam pot, I want to digress for a moment and reflect on the family roots of this bipropellant thermal reactor system that we're looking at here. The HS-293 was a rocket-powered air-launched anti-shipping missile, or glide bomb. It employed a liquid bipropellant H2O2 and permanganate reactant rocket engine for the boost phase of the flight. The same group behind the Valter hydrogen peroxide rocket engine designed the V2's steam generation system. And it's worth comparing the thrust chambers of both systems before we move on. Let me just close in and center things a bit. The high-strength hydrogen peroxide enters here, and rather than a valve, a burst diaphragm allows the H2O2 entry to the chamber through this 3mm diameter orifice. More familiar details include the permanganate projector supply pipe running down to this splash target, which is designed to encourage a vigorous reaction between the H2O2 and the calcium permanganate. Also similar, though shallower, is the reaction funnel and its location at the top of the core tube. But notice that there's no hole at the center. Incidentally, the arrow on the left of it, labeled with a capital A, is just indicating the position of welds on the core tube. In fact, the welds are for the swirl plates, seen here. They operate in the same way as they do in the V2 steam pot. Over here, we can see the same type of cutouts we saw around the perimeter of the swirl plates earlier. One slight difference that marks the change of application is the three baffles at the end of the core tube to cancel out the thrust torque created by the helical swirl plates. The V2 turbine drive application has no need for this limitation. The similarity in this technology can be made more manifest if I flip the image and shrink it up to the top a bit and lay the 1942 steam pot drawing underneath. The shared genetic heritage of these chambers is plain to see, and leads us to the unavoidable conclusion that the V2 turbine is itself powered by a rocket engine. A steam-powered rocket engine. Okay, diversion over. Let's get back to the steam pot. One of the problems with this thermal reactor type system is that too much of the combined product would find its way out of the bottom here without being fully reduced. So we could actually get hydrogen peroxide coming out of here pretty much in its unadjusted condition, unreduced condition, actually coming out of the bottom here. That means that product can end up reacting actually in the exhaust pipe passing from the bottom here. And this is one of the things they really didn't want. Not because it would cause in itself a problem, but it leads to uncertainty, especially with tiny changes in the temperature of the material that was supplied in here. Although it's fairly insensitive to temperature change, you start adding these things together, the uncertainty of exactly what's going on in here, and before you know where you are, you've got a drop in the steam pressure or something else. And remember, steam pressure goes down, the missile velocity goes down. There's no other control for the V2 other than steam pressure.
The crucial nature of the steam pressure's effect on the turbopump's rotational speed, and thereby the V2's thrust level and consequently its velocity, put this simple two-stage pressure-activated valve in the spotlight. It operates to mediate both the 25-ton thrust and the critical reduction to 8 tons thrust at the end of the boost phase. Let's see exactly how this double pressure valve operated. This whole assembly was made from 1552 stainless steel, selected for its high temperature performance. First, let's look at its construction. The smaller sub-valve at the front here has a thin metal flange at the base of the nut that gets peened over into this small hole to lock it in position once tightened. I've already released it, and unscrewed, it reveals a spring. And at the tip of the nozzle, held in place by the spring, is the spring support cum anti-clog tube. The spring support tip has multiple holes, all slightly smaller in diameter than the main nozzle orifice, to minimize the chances that any debris caught in the flow will restrict the critical flow of H2O2. Also held in place by the spring is the stainless steel ball closer. The ball is 11mm in diameter and seals off this sub-valve, sometimes referred to as a pilot valve, by the way. The primary valve only opens to pass the H2O2 when the flow is at a high enough pressure to compress the powerful spring mounted round the valve stem. I can force the valve open slightly by pressing hard on the stem, but it's not easy. There are two nuts used to set and lock the initial closed spring tension, and once unlocked, I can just take them both off the stem. The spring has a cut face and a turned and polished carrier to make sure the spring action does not foul or bind on the stem. The other spring support appears to be a separate piece of metal and has been fastened in here by micro welding or maybe by fusing.
The spring assembly is very carefully finished. The other end of the spring also has a cut and dressed face. The moving part of the main valve looks like a standard poppet type or mushroom valve, typical of the valves used to control vapor flow in vehicle combustion engines. The stem and mushroom head is a single piece of stainless steel, and the valve face has been ground at 45 degrees to the highest engineering standards of the automotive and aircraft industry. The valve stem is bored out to 5 millimeters from the threaded end. The propellant can enter this cavity and exit the valve through these two holes in the stem that connect with the central cavity. The 5mm diameter central hole at the threaded end has a fine 55 degree seat carefully ground into the rim to receive the ball bearing and provide a tight seal. The valve stem is piston fit and feels silky smooth. The valve body has 8 large holes, allowing the H2O2 unrestricted access to the valve cavity. We can see a manufacturer's code and a serial number here. There are also some extra marks, I think denoting finalization and assembly responsibility. The manufacturer three-letter code is GXZ, is for the Ernst Henkel Aircraft Works, Jenbeck in Austria. The serial number is 5985. There's a subscript 7 at the end, but I don't think that's part of the number. I'll put it back together quickly. Spring assembly, two parts, then the two nuts, one for hold and one for lock. Then the ball into the head aperture, followed by the spring. Put the support tube into the spring, cap it all with the nozzle. And that's the valve assembled. Now let's try to understand how it functioned with an animation. First, let's put it back where it belongs in the steam pod. We can see all the stuff that I took apart here. The body of the valve, two of the 8 holes that provide access to the valve body cavity, here and over here. We can see the sub-valve cavity and the main valve stem here and the ball. Now, this is slightly tricky. There's a difference in the trigger timing of the 8-ton valve versus the 25-ton flow valve. This is because the 8-ton is an electric solenoid type and the 25-ton valve is an air piston type. But both valves are opened by the same electric relay. But because of the difference in the valve technologies, solenoid versus air piston, the 8-ton valve opens first. Not by long, admittedly, about 1/3 to a maximum of 0.5 seconds typically. In principle, watch the ball, the pressure of the H2O2 drives the ball down, compressing the spring and allowing the fluid to pass the ball, flow through the nozzle and out into the pot, and so starting the generation of chemical steam and oxygen. So this may mean that a small amount of H2O2 reaches the pot, which you will recall will already have the permanganate catalyst inside, so steam generation would thus start in the 8-ton mode, if only for a fraction of a second. We don't actually know if steam was briefly generated at the 8-ton level or not, but it does seem likely. Maybe there was just enough H2O2 flushed into the valve space to prime it, and the main valve opening did all the work, and any run-up was just the action of the main flow coming to full power. I mention this mostly to satisfy the sticklers out there. Given the brevity of the difference in the dual action valve, it's a fairly academic matter with vanishingly small practical consequences. Let's close the sub-valve and get back to the sequence. So let's assume the engine is running at the primary stage, with propellants reaching the combustion chamber by gravity feed only, no pumps, and at a thrust level of just 2.5 tons. Anything you've read that suggests that the engine is running with or without pumps at 8 tons at this point is just plain wrong. But the error has been repeated many times in the literature. After a few seconds, to make sure the flame looks centered and stable, the main stage or launch button is pressed. Now there's some dispute about how exactly this double valve operated. The valve sequence I'm going to show you is the one the German technicians said was correct. But the British Army technical analysts that organised Operation Backfire, a successful post-war project to assemble a group of V-2 missiles from found parts and launch them for test purposes, said it operated slightly differently to the German version. I know you're going to say, well, what do the British know? They didn't make the thing. Anyway, I'm going to show you the sequence as the German experts understood it. Back to the sequence. The flame is centered and stable, and the launch button is pressed. Several things happen in a sequence in the missile at this point that we've covered before, but crucially, compressed air at 450 psi passes to the H2O2 and permanganate tanks. The permanganate flows from the adjacent storage tank and simultaneously into the steam pot and the attached D2R contact switch. The permanganate is fed at a pressure of 425 psi, but the contact switch triggers at just 22 psi, and only when the contact switch is triggered can the 8-ton and 25-ton H2O2 flow valves be opened. I'm showing this at a greatly reduced speed. In reality, these valve movements occur in fractions of a second. Both flow valves open, 8-ton a fraction ahead, and the sub-valve ball moves off its seat and allows some H2O2 to pass, as shown earlier. A fraction of a second behind it, the main valve moves off its seat and H2O2 floods into the pot under great pressure, and a vigorous chemical reaction begins. In fact, an explosive reaction would be a better way of describing it. Steam at 385 degrees centigrade and a pressure of over 28 kilograms per square centimeter quickly ramps the turbine up to full speed of around 4,000 RPM, and the instant the engine thrust passes 12.5 tons, we have liftoff. At this point, the main valve is fully open, and the subvalve ball may or may not settle back to its closed position. This vacillation of the ball's position is explained by the equalization of the pressure behind and in front of it. A precise answer seems academic, as the flow of the H2O2 into the steam pot is dominated by the large opening of the main valve. I've shown the ball sitting back on its seat, in line with German technical literature and post-war interview statements. When the missile's range velocity is reached, the 25-ton flow valve is closed, causing a two-thirds drop in the pressure at the large self-activating valve, and it closes. The speed with which the 25-ton flow and self-activating valves close is a problematic issue that we'll discuss in another video dealing with range velocity. So the 25-ton valve closes, followed by the pressure-activated valve. At the same time, the 8-ton so-called bypass flow valve is still open, which causes the subvalve ball to move off its seat. I'll just show you that again. This allows one-third of the H2O2 to continue flowing into the steam pot. About 4 seconds later, the 8-ton flow valve closes and the subvalve returns to the closed position. As I said, this sequence of events is not entirely consistent with the literature, and certainly not with that in the English-speaking world. I've given you the German version. The British post-war version of the sequence suggests that both valves opened and closed together, and only the H2O2 flow volume differed, and volume was determined by the 8 and 25-ton flow valves. The small, self-activating sub-valve was only there, say the British, to heat up the core tube, and had no other role. This view is not supported by the German technical literature, nor by a consideration of the history of the steam pot structure and the valves that I showed you earlier when looking at the pass hole in the bottom of the funnel, as this information was not available to the British analysts at the time. The British view was based mainly on some inconsistencies revealed in post-war interviews with German technical personnel and the results of one water-based test. Let's take a quick look at the evolution of the subvalve, looking back from February 1945. We can see the ball-controlled subvalve here, but in this drawing from March 1942, we can see that the subvalve has no ball, but a cone, or Kegel in German. This drawing from April 1942 shows it clearly. It's just one of many development changes made in this period. And if I flash the drawing back and forth, we can make a game out of spotting the changes. In 1942, the stem had a castle lock nut, but by 45, this had changed to double half nuts. The steam pot cap, having blown off the top of the pot a few times, was beefed up by 1945. The single stem hole of 42 was 2 by 1945. The permanganate throw pipe was shorter by 45. And the angle of the swell plates has become subtly steeper by 45. We already mentioned the hole in the bottom of the funnel, of course. You can go back and find some changes yourself. There are plenty more.
Thanks for watching. Until next time, bye for now.